Yeah, there's nothing to
catch my phone.
Nothing to support me. I'm having to flex my abs a lot more than I'm used to.
Yeah.
They are there.
It's a workout.
Hi, I'm Burke Holland.
I'm Nolan Lawson.
And this is five things about web performance. Do you get it? Because that was buffering?
I think I get it.
Okay. Number one, web performance is how fast a browser can load and display a web page. Today, it takes around 10 seconds to load a full web page, 22 seconds if you're on mobile. Why in the world are web pages getting so slow?
Well, there's a lot of reasons for that, but you could look at archive.org, for instance, and their statistics showing that the size of an average page is increasing over time. So it's now surpassed the size of a Doom install. It's somewhere north of 3 megabytes, the average website. And the share of JavaScript of that web page is actually increasing as well. So pages are just running more and more JavaScript, leading to things like the laptop fan suddenly starting to whir to life.
Right, as your computer starts to take off. So you're saying we should stop using JavaScript? I don't really like it anyway.
Oh, no, I love JavaScript. I've used JavaScript throughout my career. I think it's a great way to enhance web pages. I think it is kind of overused today, though. We have to find ways to limit its impact on web page performance.
Okay, well, I'm going to stop using it.
You can do that if you like. You can actually go into your browser. You can disable JavaScript if you want. Your experience on the web is not going to be so great, though.
I'm fine with that. As long as I don't have to use JavaScript, I'm good. Number two, there are a lot of different dimensions to web performance. It's not just page load time. What are some of the other aspects of web performance?
There's lots of ways you can measure web page performance. Page load time is just one of them. We call that PLT2 in the biz.
In the biz. As one does.
It is a biz. So there's PLT1, which is the first cold cache page load. There's PLT2, which is a warm cache page load. They can have very different performance characteristics. On top of that, there's also things like animation frame rate, input responsiveness, you know, how fast the page responds when you try to tap it or try to scroll, memory usage, even battery usage. You know, some websites might consume more battery than other websites. And these are all good things to take into consideration in terms of web performance.
So can we just use PLT3 and make it all go away?
I mean, if you want to just like configure your browser to load every web page on the planet twice, and then
it just seems like that would be faster. I'm just saying
it would be great. You would blow through your browser's cache pretty fast, but that would solve the problem.
Yeah, okay.
with a big enough hard drive.
That's an option. Sean Larkin gave me this Webpack shirt. Do you want it?
No, thanks.
Number three, most browsers offer tools to help you speed up your applications. What are some of the things that Microsoft Edge will do for me to help me make my applications faster?
So Edge has a lot of optimizations in place. Most of them, as is the case with other browsers, are geared around moving operations off the main thread. The main thread is where JavaScript happens. It's where layout and styling happens. And so the more you can free that up, the better. So we've been doing work like independent rendering, which we recently wrote a blog post about, to move rendering off the main thread.
What about tooling that I can use inside of Edge? Is there any tooling that can help me make my web pages faster?
We do have a performance tab inside of the F12 tools. There's also a Windows Performance Analyzer that you can use to analyze Edge performance, just as you would with any Windows application. But the best advice is to use the W3C standard performance APIs, performance.mark, performance.measure, these intersection observer is a new one that just came out that's widely supported in browsers and extremely useful for speeding up site performance.
Sounds very complicated.
It's a lot of buzzwords mostly, but as long as you just like look at whatever web standards most recently got published, usually they're pretty good.
It's a good idea. Yeah. So use intersection observer and then put it on your resume so you can get a new job because buzzwords.
Yes. Call it Intersection Observer Blockchain, actually.
Intersection, yeah, exactly. Intersection Observer, blockchain, cryptocurrency, cloud, Docker.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
You'll be a millionaire.
Yeah. Would you like a Google cluster?
I have no idea what a Google...
It's a Google cluster. It's they're from Nashville. It's like a chocolatey thing.
Oh, looks good.
Number four, CDNs used to be a great way to speed up your site by adding a little caching. Is that still something that people do, content delivery networks?
People are still heavily using CDNs, yeah, definitely. I think the conversation has got a little bit more complex now with things like bundling. So, you know, the days of kind of, you know, taking jQuery off of a CDN somewhere, putting that in your website, and then coding around that as your framework,
Are those days over? Because I'm still doing that.
Those days are still here if you want. You can live in that world if you want. But a lot of people...
I'm not leaving. I'm going to stay there forever.
It's a comfy world. It's a perfectly comfy world to inhabit. But a lot of people are doing bundling now with tools like Webpack, Browserify, Rollup.
Did you want my Webpack shirt?
No. Okay. Yeah, so when you've got this bundle of JavaScript, it's less clear the value of putting that on a CDN. But it is still definitely something you can use. But using something like Azure Blob Storage for hosting static files is like a super easy win, a really obvious thing to do for web performance in terms of moving the files closer to the user's device so that they there's less latency when they download it.
So something like taking images and putting images on the CDN, but having all your scripts and your CSS actually bundled in your application.
That's a pretty common approach now, I would say, yeah.
Okay, that's what I do every day.
Every single day?
Every single day. Every day I'm bundled.
Back to 2012?
Yeah.
2011?
Shuffling. What happened to LMFAO? Do we even need to know? Number five, server rendering is a great way to speed up your page, but I feel like we're kind of going in circles here, right? Like, put your applications on the server, and then we were like, no, put them in the browser, and they were like, no, put them back on the server. Is that what's happening? Where should the application actually live?
Well, I think it's a hard question. And the reason we've been going back and forth so much is because there's inherent trade-offs here. Like when you have the classic server-rendered static site, it's really fast for page load, relatively. But then once the page is loaded, maybe you don't have such fast in-app interactions because you keep having to go back to the server. Whereas with a client-rendered app, you know, maybe your first page load isn't so fast because you have a larger JavaScript bundle to download, but then in-app interactions are really fast. So the new generation, the new thinking, is to do this so-called isomorphic approach where you get the best of both worlds.
Ideally. Right, so render on the server when you can and render on the client when you can based on the best of each one of those capabilities.
Exactly, yeah. So for instance, there are frameworks like NextJS or NuxtJS or Sapper.js, they will try to do this automatically for you, give you the best of both worlds, so that for each route, you're first going to the server, and then from then on, once you've got that JavaScript payload downloaded, then you do everything on the client.
I do like the best of both worlds, but not as much as I like this Google cluster. I'm Burke Holland.
And I'm Nolan Lawson.
And now you know five things about web performance.